Howard is going to be my remote. So I've got my little pointer, but I'm going to nod at Howard. You're my remote today. My name is Debbie Odom. My company is Tsubaki Chameleons. We are in Savannah. We operate a retail nursery, Jean's Nursery. But like Jean said, my passion is tea. And we grow and ship tea plants all over, actually, and ornamental camellias all over the United States. We are celebrating our 60th year in business this year. Jean's dad actually started our nursery back in 1957 when he was just a little teeny, teeny baby. And so we have been in the nursery business. I have actually been in the nursery business with Jean for about 30 years. And I do love tea. We did have some rack cards, which shows our retail nursery and also my Tsubaki Tea website. Everybody says, how did you come up with the name Tsubaki? And you would be surprised at how many people can't pronounce it. So I always tell them, the tea is silent, and it's almost like tsunami. It's Japanese for chameleon. Our website is Grow Your Own Tea, also Tsubaki Tea. And we have extensive information on our site about growing and making your own tea. Jean had mentioned that the camellia garden down there is beautiful all throughout the winter. But there is a section of the camellia garden that has tea, and it was one of the first plantings, I believe, that went into the garden. They're all different types of tea plants, and if you go in, I think it's the first little path, there's a whole section of nothing but just different camellia sinensis tea plants. So you need to stop by and take a look. So who doesn't love tea? I think everybody loves tea. Actually, 85% of all tea in the U.S. is iced. And we import over 250 million pounds of tea each year. But in Savannah, we have two kinds of tea, and they're on the back table. That's sweet tea and unsweet tea. And this is what we like to refer as our sweet tea. This is my it was my little granddaughter Madison when she was about 2 years old, and she's now 11, and she's not little anymore, but she still loves her tea. Tea is a beverage made from the leaves of Camellia sinensis. Now we know you have all different other types of tea. You have chamomile, you have rose tea. They're not true tea. True tea only comes from the leaves of Camellia sinensis. And those leaves are from the tea plant, is what we call the tea plant, Camellia sinensis. It's an evergreen shrub. It is native to China, Japan, and Asia. And there has been evidence of tea being grown for over 5,000 years. And it's actually the oldest known camellia in existence. But a lot of people don't understand the connection between these big, beautiful flowering camellias and tea. How many people do not know what a camellia is? You're in a camellia society, everybody should know. They're a family of evergreen shrubs. They typically bloom fall through spring, except for the camellia azalea that's a summer bloomer down in the garden. Most of the camellias were going to grow well in zones 8, 9, and zone 7. They do really well in what we call the camellia belt, which is throughout the southeast and then up the California, Oregon, and Washington coast. They like mild temperatures, but they're absolutely wonderful. The most common camellia species are Camellia japonica and Camellia sasanqua. Camellia sasanqua is the plant that blooms in the fall, and you'll recognize it. It always shatters on the ground, so in the early fall, you have a beautiful carpet of pink and white red petals. You can use Camellia sasanqua for a lot of different things. Trees, hedges, screens, they make great, excellent container plantings, but they are traditionally not used for tea. And I say traditionally, because I had a customer one time that had bought a lot of different Camellia sasanquas for me. And so he had them, and so he called me the next year, and he said, I want to buy some more tea plants from you. He said, last year I got Winter Star, and I got Leslie Ann, and I had Daydream. So I had to tell him that those are not tea plants, those are sasanqua. And he said, oh my gosh, are you kidding me? I've been making tea from these camellia sinensis. genetic makeup in the tea plant and the way that it oxidizes that makes tea taste like tea. I've made tea from Sinensis, I've made tea from Sasanquas, and I've made tea from Japonica. The Sasanqua tea tasted like cloves. It smelled like it, it tasted like it. It was not pleasant to me. I did make tea with Japonica about a month ago. We had this little new growth of Japonica that came out, and it was excellent. So, try it. It's not going to kill you. There's no little magic poison in other camellias that you can't use. Camellia sinensis is an evergreen shrub. The reason that you want to use the tea plants to make tea during the summer is you want to make tea from the new growth. And so usually between September and March, they're not blooming. So you don't want to use the older growth. You only want the nice, soft, very fresh new growth that comes out. I had another customer that that sent a picture, and he said, my tea plant I bought from you died. And I said, well, send me a picture. Well, he sent me a picture of a plant about this big that was a stick. No leaves on the plant. He went in and pulled every leaf off of his plant in 18, so he didn't have enough leaves to absorb all the moisture that he was getting, so the plant died. You only want to harvest tea from the new growth, not the older growth. Tea is not a stranger to Georgia. Actually, tea was the first camellia ever imported into the U.S. Seeds were first sent to the Trustees' Garden in Savannah. Now, how many of you know what the Trustees' Garden was? It was the first experimental station in the Western Hemisphere. And we were trying to, during that time, get all types of plant material sourced in so we could be agricultural sustainability here with different products. And tea was one of those plants that we had tried to get in. The seeds were sent in, but they did not survive. In 1805, we had found records where tea plants were growing actively on the Landings subdivision. Basically, the tea did not survive in Georgia due to the malaria outbreak and insufficient capital and funding to actually kick that off. Go ahead. South Carolina really claims the fame to the tea production. I did not list everything here about all of the history with South Carolina, but it is intensive. And if you ever get a chance, go to my website and you'll see detailed information about all of the many, many different tea efforts. Right now, the only actively growing tea plantation in the U.S. is in Charleston, the Charleston Tea Plantation. And they produce American Classic Tea, which right now is the only tea that's being produced commercially throughout the U.S. But there are a lot of small tea farms, backyard gardeners, that are growing tea across the U.S. And we've seen increases like you do with the home brewery, you know, where people are brewing their own beer and their own wine. Now you have all of these people that are growing for their gardens and for their families because they're just an excellent crop and they can be grown in most locations. We have the ideal climate. Like I said, we're in zone 7, 8, 9, and 10. Tea can actually be a little bit more tolerant of colder temperatures than your regular flowering camellias. The plants that I have in the corner over here, I brought some samples for you to look at, had just started unfurling in March. We had 80 degrees in Bullock County at my growing farm, and then 4 days later, we dropped to 20. It burned all of the new growth, but it didn't harm the plants at all. They were just under a little bit of shade. The plants in the ground, it didn't faze them at all. So we have actually had our tea plants grow to 12 degrees without damage. So they're a lot more hardier than some things. And this shows you the little orange border. This is all conducive up into the orange and even into the yellow on where tea can be grown outdoors. So why would you want to grow your own tea? The reason I grow my own tea is because I love the plant. If you have any kind of evergreen plant in your yard, viburnums, ligustrum, tea can take that place. It's an excellent grower, very vigorous grower. Like this particular plant here, this is the spring's growth. So you're looking at 18 inches. We have some that put on 36 inches of growth a year. So they're very vigorous. They love the sun. It is just a great, beautiful fall blooming plant. It flowers in the fall. Now, you're not going to have the great, big, beautiful pinks and stripes and formal doubles. The flowers on Camellia sinensis are very small. They're white to pink, and they bloom in clusters all up and down the stem. The uses are unlimited. You can use them for screens, you can use them for hedges, a living fence, container, patio plantings, foundation plants, or even small trees. This shows you just a few of the blooms. The one here is one called Camellia sinensis rosea, which is a pink tea. It's actually a dwarf pink tea, but the foliage when it comes out is kind of a maroon to a burgundy color. It doesn't grow very fast, not as much as some of the other ones grow. This is one of the things from our field in Bullitt County. I have about 400 tea plants planted in my field up there. And you can see, this one is one of ours called Amelia tea. All of our Camellia sinensis that have girls' names are all pink. Tea provides many health benefits. I think we all know from reducing cholesterol, improving dental health, digestive issues, it really can combat a lot of different health problems. But the main thing that you want to do with Camellia sinensis is because it's a plant that you can grow in your garden, and it's safe, it's edible, and it doesn't have GMOs. So you control what pesticides, you control what fertilizers go on your plants. I don't use any pesticides on my plants on the foliage. We do have to use pesticides on plants that I ship. It's just USDA regulations. But you can grow these completely safe for your family. Some of the benefits we mentioned here. There's many different ways that you can grow tea. Now, if you have lots and lots of land, you can go plant a tea plantation. This is the living fence I was telling you about. This is an area of a picture that I saw from a place in Kenya that's about 400 feet long, and they've planted a living row of tea. Because tea grows so fast and it lends so well to pruning, you can get a very bushy, dense plant that you can keep trained to do pretty much whatever you want to do with it. This one in particular is a little dwarf plant that we've been growing. I actually call it Nana tea. It's a very short growing plant. It probably is no log taller than 18 inches tall, and it's about 10 years old. Mm-hmm. So very great. Where you have areas in your garden where you have Shilohs holly that doesn't bloom, that doesn't provide you with tea. These are excellent little tiny small plants that you can plant in into your own garden. This is one of our customers. He has some built-in planters, and they have tea plants planted in their planters. So she can go right outside the kitchen door and just pick away. Tea plants can be planted in most gardens, like I said, in zone 7 through 10. They will tolerate full sun, but you have to make sure that your plants get adequate nutrients and adequate water. They prefer very well-drained soil. If you have a tea plant in soil that is mucky or doesn't drain well, you're going to have problems. They like to be very well-drained, but they like to be moist. Sometimes that's a little difficult to do, but you want to make sure that if you're going to be planting in the garden or if you're going to be planting in containers, a very well-drained soil. They like acid soils, just like regular camellias and azaleas, 4.5 to 5.5. They're absolutely perfect plants for container gardens because you can control the height. If you don't have a place indoors or outdoors that you can plant, they're great plants. You can keep them small or you can let them grow as big as you want to get them. Like we said earlier, most are very cold tolerant. The flowers are very small. But if you're allergic to bees, this may not be the plant for you. But if you're growing honey, or plants for honey, this is the perfect plant if you're raising bees. We have a friend of ours in South Carolina that harvests tea honey. And so they make excellent, excellent plants for your bees. like we said, make sure your soil is very well drained, slightly moist, never wet. If you have to, get a moisture meter. Just because it's dry on the top doesn't mean it's going to be dry at the bottom. And so all of those roots, when you're putting them in, you want a very well-drained soil. And don't plant too deep. If you're planting regular container plants, you don't want to plant them 4 feet in the ground. We had sold some plants to the city one time, and they called us, and they said, the plants are just doing awful. So Jean and I took a trip down to Forsyth Park, and we were trying to look for the dead plants that they had. So we did. We found the plants, and so we started digging. And we dug, and we dug, and we dug, and we dug down this deep and finally found the top of the root ball. So you don't want to do that with any camellia, especially Camellia sinensis. You want it to have it ground level or slightly higher if you're going to be planting outdoors. And mulch. They love mulch. Not concrete mulch, not rocks, not rubber mulch. Real mulch. Straw, bark. Things that are going to decompose and add that organic matter back to the soil, they're really going to benefit from that. And we recommend that you fertilize regularly with organics. We use Holytone and we use Milorganite on our tea plants, and that's all we use for the most part. We're experimenting with a little granular thing, but they really do well with organics. This shows a diagram of how you would really want to plant. You're backfilling with amended soil. This is a very well-drained soil. Not potting soil, not Miracle-Gro, but something that, like a soil conditioner, little pieces of bark, you can find those at Home Depot, Lowe's, places like that, make excellent backfill. And this shows where you want to raise the ground level, like I said, ground level or slightly higher, because the plants eventually will settle. And for container grown tea plants, the rule is no bagged potting soil. Miracle-Gro and Peter's potting soil, they contain a lot of peat moss. And when you water, the water is designed to stay in these soils. So there's not a lot of oxygen flowing around those roots. So avoid the bagged potting soil. We use, and most nurseries around our area use, a bark-based potting soil. So great for tea. Okay. Go ahead, Howard. We use a mixture of different parts. We make our own potting soil. All of these components you should be able to find in a local garden center, like Hester and Zipper, I know, sells different components. The small bark on this side is very small. It's probably about an eighth of an inch. Sometimes sold as soil conditioner in garden centers. The next one is a little bigger chunks, which is probably 1 inch and less. And then we use a little bit of peat moss in with our mix. And usually we're mixing those in equal portions, so 1:1:1. And all of these instructions will be on my website if you need that. If you don't want to make your potting soil, you can use these two alternatives. The Miracle-Gro garden soil, they make two different kinds. They make one for shrubs and trees, and they make one for fruits and vegetables. You don't want the fruits and vegetables. You want the one for shrubs and trees. And their soil mix is very similar to ours. So is the Orchid potting mix. It's a very coarse blend. And it's excellent for both, for all of your camellias, not just for tea plants. Holytone, Milorganite. I would probably recommend going every 4 to 6 weeks, March through October. Once we get into October, you really don't want to feed heavy because you don't want to encourage new growth. But if you get that last feeding in October, that's going to be enough to sustain them over the winter months. If you're growing tea for tea, the idea is you want to have a really bushy plant. To get a bushy plant, you have to prune, and you need to be pruning often. What we normally like to have is what we call the pruning table, which is, if you're standing at your height, you want to have your tea plants no more than at your arm's length, because you're going to be plucking. What we normally do is, before the spring growth comes out, we'll come back in, say with a plant like this, and we'll cut it back. cut it way back to where I have about 12 to 18 inches of plant. It's going to look sticky, but what's going to happen is when the new growth comes out, it's going to explode with all of these mini tips. A plant like this, you only have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, maybe 20 tips. You want lots of tips, so you want a really bushy plant because your new growth comes from the tips. That's done through pruning. Once you do that basic pruning in pre-spring, then you're going to be plucking all summer long, and that's going to keep it maintained at a smaller level. If you're not growing for tea, then let it do what you want to do. We have plants that I don't harvest for tea that I harvest for cuttings, so I want my plants to be nice and big. Another reason on some of my plants I don't prune is because we want to harvest seeds. I think there's a thing here, we'll tell you a little bit more about that as we go along. Just like camellias, you're going to have pests on tea plants as well. Camellia tea scale is the most prevalent of all the insects for camellias. But I haven't seen as bad of infections on tea plants with tea scale and spider mites as I have with japonicas and sasaquas. I don't know if that's due to the caffeine content or the genetic makeup of the leaf. They will have scale, and it's very easy to treat and keep them treated so you don't have a problem later on. You also have aphids in the spring. Aphids actually cause more damage to tea plants and caterpillars, moths, and beetles than tea scale and mites do. We only use organic methods for spraying on our plants. We use an all-seasons oil spray. Now, you can get that most anywhere, Home Depot, Lowe's, garden centers, and it is an excellent, excellent plant. But I would caution you, don't use it when the flowers are blooming. It's probably not going to hurt your bees, but you don't want to spray anything during the blooming time, just as a precaution in case bees happen to get in and are pollinating. The best way to do it is get those little hose on sprayers and you fill the oil into the sprayer and then you can just spray on a regular basis. If you spray spring, summer, and fall, you should be able to keep all of these little insects at bay. The oil will definitely work on the mites, it'll work on scale, and it'll work on the aphids, but it won't do much for caterpillars or beetles. The only thing to do with things like that is to watch for them. I don't have a lot of trouble like this one. I see the one little place where I've had some beetles. I really see those more on the japonicas and sasaquas and those type than I do on the tea plants. And good old Dawn, you can't beat Dawn. It is one of the best things that we have used. It takes care of aphids, takes care of mites, scale, and it just really, makes the plants just really beautiful. And you can spray this in most any temperatures. It won't harm your plant. It won't harm the environment. It may even deter some caterpillars and leafy bugs, and it may even deter deer.
Mm-hmm.
It may. Not promising, but it may. Okay. There are three types of tea. There's green tea, oolong tea, and black tea. And that's actually not true. There's a lot more, but those are the most common types of tea. All tea is made from one plant. There's not a green tea plant or a black tea plant or a white tea plant. They're all comes from one plant. It's the way you process it that depends on what you get. Now tell people to think about potatoes. And you start with a bag of potatoes. You mash them, they become mashed potatoes. You slice them and fry them, they become french fries or potato chips. One potato, the way you process it, ends up with getting what you actually end up with. Black tea is my favorite. It is a process where the leaves are broken, bruised, and twisted. And this breaking of the cell walls is what causes the plant to oxidize. That changes the structure of the plant. It changes it in aroma, and in taste, and in appearance. Oolong tea, which is actually my favorite, it's kind of a cross, a little bit green, a little bit black. It actually has less caffeine than the black. The black tea actually has more caffeine than the other three. It has a very mild taste. This is one that I made out of one of my batches. Every time I make a batch of tea, it's different. Sometimes I'll get it that looks like that. Sometimes it's a pretty gold color. And the taste is different. There's only 50 to 75 milligrams of caffeine per 8 ounces of oolong tea. And green tea is not allowed to oxidize. So you're not breaking and bruising and twisting, and you're not allowing that browning to occur. The browning that occurs with tea plants and tea leaves is the same thing that happens when apples are cut or when bananas sit on your counter. They're all oxidizing. And that's the exact same thing that happens with tea. With green tea, you're not allowing it to do that. When you harvest tea, like I said, you only want to harvest it from the active new growth. In our area, that can be anywhere from the 1st of April through September. It all depends on the weather. This year, we have our first flush in March. Normally, we don't get our first flush until probably latter April or May. You only want to harvest the soft new growth. Can you go back? For most tea, you want to harvest a leaf and a bud, or actually two leaves and a bud. That is called the bud. It's actually a third leaf that is not unfurled yet. This one is one that has just unfurled, and then this one's going to be the next one down. That is your common, what they call a pluck. That's normally what you would pick. If you're going to be making white tea, you only want the bud. If you want to make, I think it's silver tea, you want the bud before it has even started to open. So with silver and white tea, they're very pure. The caffeine content is stronger, but also the flavor is stronger in the bud that's not unfurled. I'll pass this around so you can see that blue one on the top. That one is actually, yes, silver or white.
And the mouth has to be hand-picked.
Yes, white tea and that. And usually with white tea and silver tea, it's only the first flush that's picked. So once you pick this time, then what you would do later on would not really be considered white and silver, because you've got all of these hormones that have dumped into the plant. So first flush tea is always the purest and the sweetest. Green tea, like I said, is the easiest. You would want to go out and pick. I normally pick in the morning where there's dew still on. There's something just so cool about going out and picking your fresh tea with dew on them. Go ahead. You want to pick the soft green growth, a bud and two leaves. Now I have a little screen, and normally I'll wither my pluck tea out in the shade. That's why I like to do it in the morning, because the temperature is a little milder. So all you're doing is you're picking and you're just letting it rest. You want to let it rest for about an hour. And then you go into a steamer pot. This is just one method. You can go into a steamer pot, or if you have a wok or a frying pan, you can do it on just a heat where you can put your hand in the bottom of the pan, and you can just fluff it with your hands or with a spatula. What you're doing by steaming or by frying is you're stopping any type of fermentation or oxidation. You're actually stopping the growing process. After it's steamed, you can put it out on a tray. At this point, once it gets to this stage and the leaves come out and they're wet, a lot of tea makers will then roll them. You'll roll them or twist them into little balls. Then you would want to let them dry, and then you just store them. To dry them, you want to go into an oven, 250 degrees, for about 3 to 5 minutes. All you're doing is just trying to make sure the last bit of moisture is up. I have varied with my green tea. I've not found one method that works well for every time I've produced. Sometimes I put it in for 3 to 5 minutes and it's burned. Sometimes I put it in for 3 to 5 minutes and it's still wet. And a lot of it has to do with the moisture content. So you really want the moisture content to drop about 70%. Experience is going to tell you how to get there before you go into the oven. And then I just store mine into an airtight container. Now, I'll tell you with green tea, I don't like green tea. I like the little packaging of Lipton green tea because that tastes good. To me, fresh green tea is really earthy. It's really grassy. It does kind of remind you of freshly mown grass, you know, drinking freshly mown grass. Some people like it, some people don't. I'm not a big fan of green tea, but it's excellent for you. Oolong tea is my favorite because it really lets me get in and get my hands dirty and actually manipulate the tea leaves to produce a light gold coppery color, but it also you're getting that taste of the tea. Like I said before, it's oolong is kind of little green, little black, and I equate it to if you make regular tea and then you water it down to where you can just barely taste the tea taste, that's what oolong is. Oolong, new growth is harvested from Camellia sinensis tea plants. And on these, I put them on a tray. Now on this one, I didn't have it on my screen. I just had it on a regular cookie sheet. And I put it in the shade, and I withered it for about 3 to 4 hours. And after about an hour, you'll start to see it just try to wilt a little bit. Once it starts to wilt, then you really start getting in and you're working with it. And you're just twisting and crushing and bruising. And you just go through all of the leaves, and then you let it sit for another hour. Then you come back in, you twist. When it gets to about 3 to 4 hours, then you actually start smelling it, and it really smells like tea. And it's starting to look like tea. Go ahead. You can't see this very well, but this had withered down to where I was comfortable with it. It really smelled great. So I put it in the 3 to 5 minutes in the oven to dry, and then I stored it in airtight containers.
Well, when you bruise them at all, are you making them smaller? Or are you?
You're doing is by bruising it, you're doing the same thing as if you drop an apple on the floor. It bruises it and it causes it to start oxidizing. So by crushing the leaves, you're causing the tannins to be released in the leaf, and that results in the brown color and the smell. Because when you pick this and you smell it, it smells like grass. It doesn't smell like tea. But once it started to oxidize, then you can really start to get that smell from it.
So you're not tearing the leaves.
You can tear, crush, crumble. In commercial facilities where they have mechanical methods to do it, what they do is they have these big rollers and they put it out on a tray and the rollers come through and they're just cutting. They're cutting. And then you have another machine that'll come through and then they roll it like the rolling pin. I've done that before. I've actually ripped them and then I've actually got a rolling pin. I just put them on the counter and roll it. Just anything to bruise it. My grandkids, Madison and Jacob, they love to do that. And I tried to see if I could get a picture up here with them doing it. They get so excited because they're just squeezing and bruising and rolling. Black tea is a lot more complicated. I've only made black tea one time because I'm an impatient person. And I don't have 10 to 12 hours or 2 days that I can just sit there and devote to that. But basically with black tea, you have to be able to maintain a high humidity but a cool temperature. That's what really causes black tea to become black tea. But then the rolling and the twisting and the crushing and bruising continues over a longer period of time. So you're really getting that full oxidization process on it. I haven't worked it out, but oolong is really the better method for those. And that is my program. If you'd like to purchase our tea plants, we have tea plants at our nursery. We're actually going to be having an open house Friday and Saturday, and I'll be there both days. Have cards there. If you want to go online, I'd love for you to visit my website and see all of my information there. And I'll be happy to take any of your questions. Yes?
Do
same instance, is just like it is with most shrubs. The more sun you give them, the more they'll grow and the bushier they'll be. They are going to do better if you give them full sun. You're going to have a much bushier plant. Matcha tea. Have you ever heard of matcha? It's the green tea powder. What they do to produce matcha is they grow plants in the full sun, but before they harvest the tea, they move it into heavy shade, and then they pluck. Something about the decrease in light intensity makes the matcha more stronger, more intense, but then it's actually dried and pulverized into a powder that mixes in with water. But we grow all of ours in full sun. If you have an area that gets too hot, you don't have enough irrigation going to it, and you can do it in shade. You just won't have as bushy a plant.
How tall do they get if you let them grow?
If you let them grow, they'll never really reach maturity, but there are some that we've seen that are 20-25 foot tall. In fact, one of the types of Camellia sinensis is called Camellia sinensis asamica. And asamica has huge leaves. The leaves on asamica are like this. They're 8 to 10 inches long. And they grow on big trees. And in China and India, basically, where asamica is derivative, they're all grown in the trees. And the tea pickers climb up the trees and pick the tea leaves. And they're pretty tall, 15, 20 foot. They're climbing up to pick these tea leaves.
So the question is, you've got the leaves stored in a dry place.
Yes.
How long do you keep them there, and then what do you do to brew your tea?
To brew your tea, you brew just like you would brew a normal cup of tea. Your tea is probably going to be loose leaf. I have these little, if you've ever purchased loose leaf tea, then they make these little strainer things that you can get, that you can put your tea in. You brew it the exact same way. I'll give you a little hint. All tea is caffeinated. Decaf tea is one that has been brewed prior and then re-dried. You can decaffeinate any tea by, even if you have a caffeine tea bag, you pour the water in, you brew it, and you let it sit for a minute. Take the tea bag out, and throw that water out. You start with another fresh cup of water, put your tea bag in, and you've reduced the caffeine content 60%.
The same tea bag.
Same tea bag, Yeah. The caffeine is always released in that first brew.
Can you tell the difference in the tea that you made from the different varieties that you're growing?
No.
And you were showing different pictures of different.
Yes. What you're going to find with the differences in tea, you may have differences in climate. So tea that we produce here may be different from tea produced in North Carolina. But from plant to plant, you should not notice any difference. Yes?
From the reason that you want the different varieties, you just took you got three.
The difference in varieties is basically for landscape gardening people.
Right.
Because you have different plants with different looks. Like this one is more of your traditional Chinese type tea plant, has narrow leaves, it grows upright. This plant has larger leaves, it's more dense. They look like two different plants. And that's what one of the things that we're looking for. We grow hundreds and hundreds of seedlings, and they're babies to me. And I go out and we have all these tea plants growing, and I'll look and I'll see one that has a different leaf structure than this one. And so I'll pull it out, stick it over here in this spot. We've actually developed about 40 different varieties of tea plants, and they all look different. They all perform different. But the tea made from these plants, you should not be able to tell the difference.
All taste the same.
All taste the same. Because it's your processing method that makes the type of tea that you get. With the exceptions of one, the one that I was telling you about, the asamica is like, it's grown in India. And that tea is more used in India, not for green, black, and oolong, but for really high quality black teas. I've never made tea from asamica. I've been told that if you try to make green or black from asamica plants, that they're almost a milky texture. I've not done it, so I can't tell you yes or no, but that would be the only thing I would think that we can do. tea every 7 to 14 days through the growing cycle. How many plants you have, or how much tea comes in the plant, depends on how many tips you get. So if you have a really bushy plant, you should be able to get enough, or at least a few cups out of one bush per plucking. Keep in mind that it takes 60,000 leaves to make a pound of tea. So that's a lot of tea. So, you know, if you had, for an average family, if you had 10 to 15 plants, you could probably produce all the tea that you would want for your family. If you grow it commercially, you need millions. We normally start getting flowers late August. And what will happen is the flowers will come out, they're self-pollinating, but they'll also pollinate with other tea plants. And everywhere you have a flower, you have a seed pod. And the seed pods develop and they grow all year long, and then the following fall, you'll harvest the tea seeds and then you can plant the seeds. Now, just like with camellias, when you plant a tea seed, you don't know what you're gonna get. With tea plants, it's the same thing. If this plant crossed with that plant, or this plant has something in its history, it can show up in seedlings. We've had seeds from large growing plants to produce seedlings that are dwarfs. So you never know what your seedlings are going to get with it. But yes, all of these little green balls are all tea seeds, and you'll be able to harvest those when they start to crack, usually mid-September, October.
Can they cross with other forms of camellias?
Yes, yeah, they are compatible. They're Yeah, they don't, it's not as prevalent because you don't usually have them blooming at the same time. Now there are some sustainables that have been crossed with sinensis hybrids. We've not done any kind of caffeine testing. You know, what the genetic makeup of those hybrids would be. Anytime you cross two different species, considered a hybrid. And with those, we just don't know. There's just not a lot of them out there. We've not done it, but we have some that a friend of ours had crossed. Now you can do manual crosses, which is what I've been trying to get him to do for years. Because I really have my heart set on this plant called purple tea. I don't know if you've ever heard of purple tea. Purple tea is exactly what it's called. It's a Camellia sinensis plant, but it's purple. The foliage is purple, it almost resembles red tips. They're not available in our country. They're in a limited area in China. And then there are purple tea plants in Kenya. And I was just telling Freya earlier today that I had gotten with a guy in Kenya to try to order tea seeds, purple tea seeds, and because the U.S. government won't let us bring in plant material. Anything that has the camellia to it is just the kiss of death. Won't get any plant material in. So they'll let us bring seeds. And so we worked for months with this guy in Kenya to bring seeds in. And so we thought we had done everything right, and they were shipped into Memphis, and the agricultural department destroyed my seed. My seeds. And they wouldn't tell me why. So I paid $300 for the tea seeds, and I was not going to do that again without knowing what, you know, happened. But I feel sure that it had the word committee connected. So right now, I'm still on the quest for purple tea, so y'all keep following me, so one day I'll have it. Any other questions? Yes?
Since we're not looking for flowers at the time from seedling coming up to harvesting, tea is proportionately shorter, I guess,
yes,
than it is for starting.
Yes.
Producing flowers.
Yes, that is correct. I can grow a tea plant from a seed and bloom it in 2 years, whereas camellias are entirely different, which is really great because I do look for that garden appeal, and I'm looking for the pink flowers, and I'm looking for the different types of foliage, and I can see that much quicker with a seedling than I can with regular camellias, which can take sometimes 7 to 10 years, you know, before you blossom a seed. So they're they're incredibly different plants, but they belong to the same family. Any other questions? Well, thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.
I told you she was smart. Next month, we're going to talk about how to propagate cuttings and how to plant those seeds. And so if you've ever wanted to know how to do this, you need to be here and you need to bring friends with you. And unless they have a wedding or a banquet, we're at the other building, right? Yes. And so we'll be in the big building back there. And so hopefully we can continue this with our meet and greet, so you've got a little more time, it's a little more relaxed, we can get to know each other and have lots of fun, because that's what this is all about. And also, if you have any suggestions about things that you think we should do, by all means, email them in, and we'll take a look at them, because we want to make everybody happy. So, thank you for coming. We appreciate it.